to spend my life mending broken people. I want to spend my life removing pain. Lord, let my words heal a heart that hurts. I want to spend my life mending broken people. I want to spend my life mending broken people.
Hello, friends, and welcome to another 3ABN Today program. It's a blessing to join with you each and every day. Thank you for tuning in to 3ABN.
That's right.
We always appreciate your prayers and support of the ministry of 3ABN. Many of you have stood with us from the very beginning of 3ABN, and thank you so much, because you know what? We're a team, and we're on a winning team because we're on Christ's side, aren't we? And it's all about winning souls for Jesus Christ. So thank you again for your support through all the years, and it's neat to hear how God is working in many people's lives. And today we have a wonderful interview, don't we?
We do. I like the Today program because we can feature and show testimonies of people whose lives have been changed, people who have stepped out into ministry and are impacting other people's lives. And we have such a guest today. Mm. Our special guest today is Tim Rumsey. He is a speaker director for Pathway to Paradise Ministries. And Tim, we're just so glad to have you here today.
Thank you. Good to be here.
We're looking forward to hearing your story and what Pathway to Paradise Ministries is all about and unpackaging what he does. Mm. And it's an exciting testimony.
It really is, because it's neat, because in this interview today, you're going to hear what God is doing in his life and in his ministry, but also it's a call to you, because all of us are called. We have a purpose, and that is to spread God's love to others. And we don't maybe necessarily have to have a ministry with a so-called maybe name like Pathway to Pathway, make sure I get this
Pathway
right.
Pathway to Paradise.
Paradise. But you can be in your own living room, in your church, and God has a plan for you too. So we want you to remember that as we go through this wonderful story and what God is doing today in this ministry.
Amen. And that's why we want to hear the testimony of Tim Rumsey and his family, to hear how God is working in their lives, in this ministry, having them step out into ministry, how they got involved in ministry, and how God wants each one of us to be involved in ministry as well. Before we go to his testimony and as he shares about the ministry, we want to go to a scripture. I asked him before the program began if they have a certain scripture that they especially use or especially like with this ministry. And the scripture is Psalm 119, verse 105. I'm sure you can quote it with me. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Before we go to his testimony, we want to have some music. We're going to be hearing from Sandra Enterman. She is a wonderful friend of this ministry, and we always love it when she comes and when she can minister music to us. And she will be doing the song, O Calvary's Lamb.
This faltering tongue would dare to speak of thee, my Lord, from one so weak. I must not keep from thee my praise, for thy glory I will lift my voice and sing. O Calvary's Lamb, O righteous one, for sinners died whose sins were none. All that I have to thee. Before thy throne, with those redeemed, unto thee, O Lord, I lift my voice and sing. For sinners died whose sins were none. All that I have, all that I am, I owe to thee, O Calvary's Lamb. Died whose sins were none. All that I have, all that I am, I owe to thee, O Calvary.
Amen. Thank you so very much, Sandra. Mm-hmm. What a powerful song.
Amen.
Oh, Calvary's Lamb. And I tell you, we praise the Lord for Jesus Christ and that gift that He gave to us, the gift of salvation so many years ago. And that's what we want to continue to spend our lives doing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Is to spread God's love and that gift of salvation to others.
Amen. That's right. If you're just joining us, we have special guest Tim Rumsey with us with Pathway to Paradise. I got that? Pathway to Paradise Ministries. And Tim, we're so glad to have you here. Before we talk about the ministry and how God called you into that, take us back to who you are and maybe a little bit of growing up and...
Sure.
Now share maybe a little about your family, because I know that your family is not on the set. They're here close by, but tell us a little bit about your family as well.
Certainly. Well, let's start with the picture of my family, because this isn't just my ministry. It's something that we're doing together as a family.
What a cute.
Oh, they're precious.
So tell us your wife's name and your children.
Yeah, my wife, Stacy, and our three children. This picture is actually almost a year old, so we're going to need to get a new one. But right behind me is our oldest son. His name is James.
Okay.
He's 4 and a half right now.
Adorable.
And then his brother is peeking out behind Stacy there. His name is Paul. He'll be 3 in just a couple of weeks.
Aww.
Wow. And then our little baby girl, Jenna, is about 1.5 years old right
wow.
now.
What great smiles.
I know we met you at ASI
past
summer at ASI, and we're just blessed by the ministry and by what God has called you to do. But did you grow up in a Christian home? Were you always Christian?
Yes. Grown up as a Christian, as an Adventist. Had a wonderful home, wonderful parents, and what a blessing that has been. Very thankful for that as well. Just a little background on me. I'm a musician by training.
Okay.
I taught music in a couple of our academies, our boarding academies, for about a decade.
What type of music?
Band was my area. Okay. I've taught choir and handbells and piano lessons as well. You kind of do everything.
Oh yeah.
When you're teaching. And composition is where I've received a lot of my training.
So your degree's in music then?
Degree's in music.
Ooh, yes. I did not know that. Okay.
So this shift into ministry is something new for us, and it's something that we've definitely have seen the Lord guiding us into. Otherwise, I'm sure I'd still be teaching music somewhere. We're just humbled and thankful to see how the Lord works with everybody. He has a purpose and a plan for everybody's life. And it doesn't matter what our background is or where we've been or what we have or haven't done, He still has that calling and that that purpose for us.
So tell me, in the call to step out into ministry here, you were teaching, you're doing music, you're satisfied, fulfilled. Did you feel like an emptiness, like, wow, I should be doing something different? Or how did that come about?
It was kind of a surprise to me. It actually happened a few months after we were married.
Ooh.
And so this is one reason that we see this really as God's calling for our family.
Okay.
All of us, both of us at the time before we had children, to make this step. An evangelist came through our local church for a weekend, and at the end of his meetings, he made several appeals and calls, but one of those was, if you feel the Lord calling you to full-time gospel ministry, then come forward. And we were sitting on the back row of the church, and all of a sudden my wife looked over and I wasn't there anymore because I was walking up to the front.
Wow.
And as I was talking with her later that afternoon, she said, when I saw you go up, I knew something was happening because, you know, you're not the kind of person that usually just goes up for these kind of things. And definitely felt the Lord and Holy Spirit urging me, wow, you need to make this commitment.
You know, that's amazing because when you think about, you know, your involvement with young people, correct? You're teaching band and an academy. You have a lot of impact, positive impact, you know, for young people. So to make this decision sounds like just like that. The minister, evangelist gave a call and you responded.
Well, we began praying earnestly that the Lord would show us, you know, what does this mean? At this point, we feel kind of like Abraham.
Yeah.
We don't know where we're going.
So this is after you went forward?
After I went forward.
Okay. You started praying earnestly, God, what do you want me to do?
Yeah.
Wow.
And we prayed for about 8 months that the Lord would show us what he wants us to do. And he actually sent me back into teaching again. And
music or something
music
different?
Music once again,
okay.
Yes. And it was a wonderful experience. And I actually had the opportunity at that new position to teach some Bible as well.
Now, what school was this at?
That was at Bass Memorial Academy.
Okay,
Mississippi.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, I want to just touch on this briefly because, you know, I think this could be an experience for many people.
Mm. Mm.
You feel that God has called you to do something, so you step out, which you did. You know, you felt, man, God, I need to do something. You felt the call, so you went forward, and then you prayed, and it seemed as though nothing happened. Could we say that? And then you went back into what you were doing. And so that could really, I mean, to be honest with you, that happens, I'm going to say, to many people because it's happened to me too. And it could be almost a confusing time in somebody's life. Like, okay, was that really God then that I felt talking to me? How did you deal with all of that? Was that confusing for you?
Well, like I said, we had prayed for 8 months
and
we finally set up a deadline because we needed to let our current employers know what we were going to do.
And of course.
After 8 months of praying, the Lord answered those prayers one night before the deadline. We got the phone call from Bass Memorial Academy.
Okay.
So at that point, it's not something you can really ignore or brush aside. You have to say, this is obviously the Lord leading here.
Wow.
And so we definitely knew that this is what he wanted us to do.
So from your current school you were employed at, then you moved to Bass Memorial.
That's right.
Okay. And you felt like this is part of the call, like God has this call, and I don't know exactly how you're going to fold it, but this is what God's, how he's leading.
That's right.
Wow.
We were there for 3 years, had wonderful experience, met lots of really great people, and eventually moved on from that and moved to Colorado and went to work for my father-in-law. So kind of joined the family business for a while.
What does he do?
He develops and manages assisted living facilities.
Okay.
And so that was a great experience as well, very different from teaching.
Oh, yes.
But that gave me the opportunity through connection with some of the local churches out there in Colorado to begin doing some speaking. And one of the churches kind of stepped out and gave me the opportunity to do an evangelistic series. And
So did you know when you went forward, when that evangelist made the call, did you know, okay, God, this is what the ministry is going to look like? Or you really had no idea? You just knew there was a call in my life, but I don't know exactly what it's supposed to look like.
We didn't have a clue what it really meant. We were excited. Yeah. We knew that this definitely was something the Lord is leading. But at least for us in our experience, we've never seen the big picture.
Yeah.
Seems like God works that way. He shows you just what you need for the next step.
Amen.
But that builds faith.
Yeah, it reminds me of Abraham. I was just thinking of Abraham. He was called to go into a land and country. He really didn't even know what he was going to be doing there, where he was going, actually. But he knew God had called. Tell us a little bit about what Pathway to Paradise is, what your ministry is, because we're starting to now talk about the evangelistic part of it. What is Pathway to Paradise?
That's the name of that first series that I wrote, the evangelistic series. It was named Pathway to Paradise.
That you did in Colorado?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And Jesus, of course, is the pathway.
Okay.
And the way, the truth, and the life.
Amen.
And so when we were looking for a name for the ministry itself, we couldn't think of anything better than that.
Oh, that's a great name.
And that's what we try to do no matter what we're doing. And we're going to be talking about some different programs as we move forward here. But the focus and purpose of all of those is to direct people to Jesus, show them what it means to walk with Him today.
Yeah, that's right.
So you were working for your father-in-law, doing the family business, and then doing evangelism on the side, or how did that work?
He gave me quite a bit of free time to do evangelism and try to build this ministry as I was working for him, which I was very grateful.
That's a blessing.
Oh, yeah. Wonderful
support. He has a heart for the church and the Lord's work as well. About a year ago, we were doing an evangelistic series up in Montana. And as we were doing that series, which lasted for about a month, my wife and I both just became very convicted that when the Lord had called us into full-time ministry, that's actually what He meant.
Oh, wow.
Full-time. Don't be doing this and try to work in the family business. Don't be doing this and try to do anything else. This is what I want you doing. So we started really praying about that.
Oh, that's serious.
Wrestling with that.
Yes.
And we didn't say anything to her parents, my boss.
Yeah.
And when we got back from that series, we live on the same property together. So when we got back home, the very first thing that my father-in-law said was, "Welcome back. How do we get you doing this ministry full-time?" And to
that's
us,
Jesus.
Wow.
Absolutely.
Confirmation.
And so my mouth kind of dropped down and I picked it back up. Put my tongue back in and said, "Wow, okay." And then we shared with him what we've been praying about for the last 3 or 4 weeks.
And then what happened just that weekend, right? Before.
Oh, absolutely.
Just before you came home.
Yeah, at the beginning, and at the beginning of that series, we had sent off our application for a 501c3 status.
Okay. Mm.
And we had been told to wait for that 12 to 18 months. Mm-hmm. And within 4 weeks, it came back approved.
Mm-hmm.
So that was just another confirmation in the Lord's view, it was time to step forward.
Yeah. That's a scary thing, to step out and to think, I'm totally dependent on the Lord and the donations of other people to support this ministry.
It is, but at the same time, it's the most comfortable, safest place you can be as well.
Amen.
If you know that this is what the Lord is leading. Mm-hmm. It grows your faith for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's for sure. Yeah, because I'm thinking, you're man of the house, I am for the two of us. That's a lot of responsibility because you also have, I got to take care of my family. But like you said, couldn't say it better. It's the most comfortable place to be.
Yes.
In the will of God.
That's so, right.
Yeah. Amen.
So how has that journey been?
Well, we've been doing this full time now.
For about a year?
Almost a year. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we've stayed busy. So praise the Lord for that.
Yeah. Amen. Wow. Yeah.
So what does your ministry look like? What does it entail? What projects? I know you mentioned evangelism, but there's also another initiative called SHINE you're involved in, right?
That's right. This is something we're really excited about. As my wife and I were thinking about and talking about what is this ministry going to look like, and of course praying and studying as well, my wife has such a passion for children, for her children, for other people's children, for families.
Amen.
And we really started praying, Lord, show us how our children can not just tag along behind us as we go different places and do different things in this ministry, but how can our children actually be part of the ministry. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so that was kind of what fueled the idea for SHINE.
That's important. I actually like that because a lot of times children can sort of be thought of as just tag along or leave them at home or someone else, but you're actually wanting to incorporate them as part of your ministry, but absolutely, then make that a ministry in itself.
Absolutely. And
it's great.
Also help other families understand how this can become a part of their lives, whether they're in full-time, quote-unquote, ministry or not. How do we get the entire family involved?
Amen. Now, we have a video?
Yes.
Of that. So let's go to that. It's now a good time to go to it. Okay, let's go to that video here of SHINE at this time.
Mm-hmm. Jesus loves me, this I know. I want to tell the world so.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
God has always had a remnant generation, a generation of children who would not be bought or sold. Children who in their inmost souls were true and honest. Children who did not fear to call sin by its right name. Children whose conscience was as true to duty as the needle to the pole. Children who stood for the right, though the heavens may fall. Today, in the time of the end, God will again have a remnant generation that shines as the brightness of the firmament and turns many to righteousness. Pathway to Paradise Ministries presents SHINE, a family camp meeting, spiritual retreat, and youth-presented public evangelistic series combined in one life-changing week. Activities include parenting seminars, workshops on developing creative family worships, training to teach children how to lead Bible studies, and a public evangelistic series presented entirely by children. To learn more about SHINE and to register your family, visit www.shinekids.net. That's www.shinekids.net.
SHINE!
Incredible. Wow.
Amen.
What an amazing ministry just SHINE is. So you got to tell us a little bit more about this, because I can see people at home. I mean, if we had children too, I know we'd want to be involved in this. But
yes.
You're saying, whoa, I want to get involved. Tell me more about that. I know you had a website. You may want to repeat that. And we're going to give an address roll here at the very end of this program. So get your pencil and pen out and a piece of paper. But tell us a little bit more about SHINE, because I know this is a very exciting aspect of Pathway to Paradise.
Certainly. This is going to kind of be a cross between a family camp, a summer family camp,
okay,
and a family camp meeting.
Ooh.
And so I'm saying it will be, because we've never done it before.
Mm-hmm.
The first time will be next summer of 2017.
Okay.
We'll be at Fletcher Academy.
Nice.
Fletcher, North Carolina.
You already have it booked then?
We do.
Okay.
And we're going to be partnering with the Academy and also the Hendersonville Seventh Day.
I see that June 26th through July 1st.
That's right.
Okay. Okay.
Those are the dates, and the website again, shinekids.net. Okay. There's a lot more information than we'll have time to go over here.
Sure. So basically, if they want to sign up, I'm sure you have to sign up, right? It's not just show up. You need to register.
That's correct.
Okay. So in order to do that, go to the website, which is
shinekids.net.
Shinekids.net.
Okay.
That's right. I want to read a short statement. This is from Testimonies to the Church, Volume 6, page 202. In the last days, children's voices will be raised to give the last message of warning to a perishing world. When heavenly intelligences see that men are no longer permitted to present the truth, the Spirit of God will come upon the children, and they will do a work in the proclamation of the truth which the older workers cannot do, because their way will be hedged up.
Mm.
It's interesting, when we look at the history of the Reformation in Scandinavia, if you read the book, The Great Controversy, God did this at that time as well. He moved upon the children, and He gave the message through them.
Oh, yeah.
And we understand and believe the same thing is going to be happening again in the future.
Yeah.
And so SHINE is really our humble attempt to inspire and help equip families so that they can raise their children in such a way that the Lord can use their kids in part of this final message.
Oh, that's exciting. Praise God.
So the focus of the week is spiritual. There is some recreation and different family activities, but it's not like a summer camp in the sense, you know, there's not horseback riding and water skiing. Those are great, great activities, but right. The focus here is on the spiritual. And want to really give families opportunity to practice evangelizing with all members of the family in different ways. So during the week, there's parenting seminars. There's practice for the children in their role, which I'll explain more in just a minute.
Okay.
There's opportunities for door-to-door work. The whole family can go out together.
Oh, I like that.
So the family's going to experience this week together as a family.
It's really evangelism, it's outreach, it's training. That's exciting. That's right. So when they go out door-to-door, they would be like selling books, or are we talking like taking Bible study interests or praying with people, or?
Well, we're going to work like? With the local church.
Okay.
And we're going to, you know, ask, how can we help you the most? What do you see your needs are in the community?
Good.
And we'll certainly be passing out literature, inviting people to the public meetings at the end of the week. And maybe I'll talk about that a little bit, because that's really kind of the unique highlight of the series or the program. Friday night, and then Sabbath morning, and then Sabbath afternoon. So three programs. The public will be invited in to the local church there. And the kids are going to present the entire presentation.
Wow.
So they'll do the preaching. They'll do the special music. They'll do the greeting and the scripture and prayer.
Amen.
We're hoping that they can help run some of the audio and video as well. Just every aspect of that outreach will be presented by the children.
Wow.
As a way to help them realize, hey, this is a way that I can get involved. And they can do some of these things. I think a lot of kids have a passion to share, and they need the opportunity to do that.
Yeah, sometimes as adults, I think we can sort of stymie that. Well, you're not quite grown up enough. But here they're given the opportunity too. I have a question. So the camp is about 1 week in length. And so the closing weekend, right, Friday night, you said, and then Sabbath, the young people are doing the service, the services. So are these young people in the months prior getting ready for this whole series? Or is this just 1 week of like, okay, here, this is what you're going to speak on, and they pretty much have to put this together in 1 week's time?
Good question. Okay. Registration actually closes May 15, over a month before this starts. And there's a reason for that, and that's because the kids need time to prepare.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Now, when a family registers for this and they say, hey, we want to be part of this, we're going to work with the family, and we're going to work with the children to find the best role for them.
Great.
And what fits
That's
them best.
Good.
Find their find the strengths and weaknesses, maybe. Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of children I know that don't want to get up front and preach. And that's great, because we need lots of other roles. Mm-hmm. We need people to do prayer teams. Mm-hmm. You know, if a child is good at artwork, we need some art for the PowerPoints and different parts that we need art for. So we're going to do everything we can to plug that kid into the best role that fits them the best.
That's good, because God calls all of us to ministry, but we all don't have the same gifts.
Right.
And when you mentioned the kids might be doing audiovisual, or they might be greeting, or that's wonderful, because some would be friendly and want to greet, some want to get up and speak, you know, have that burden and passion. But God can use each one in that ministry. That's powerful.
Now, for those children that are going to be doing the speaking, it will be scripted for them. So we'll give them a script.
So they don't have to create something.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. We'll give them the PowerPoints to practice with. And then those 3 or 4 days of the week itself, we're just putting the pieces together. I'll go back to my music teaching experience. You know, there's a reason music teachers tell their students, you have to practice this before the concert.
That's right.
Those final rehearsals are just to fit everything into place. It's not to learn your music. So we're not learning the material during SHINE itself. We're just putting it all together.
Yeah, I tell you, it sounds like an amazing week. So do you have a lot of slots or spaces for families to come? Is this like a couple hundred, or are you looking more to very small?
Yeah, what are you looking for?
Yeah, Fletcher Academy has room to comfortably house somewhere between 20 to 25 families.
Okay.
Nice.
So
it's not that big, but it's big enough to have a good group there.
Amen.
So I want to encourage you then, because this is probably going to fill up really quick. So if you're interested, I would start researching this, and I guess there's probably maybe even contact in there. They can email or a phone number that they can reach you guys at, and start finding out more about this, because this sounds really exciting. And it's not just it sounds like it's going to be fun, but it's also based on ministry of reaching souls for Jesus Christ. And wow, what a way to inspire young people. I know that mission trips are very inspiring to young people. So this is sort of like that, but it's right here in the States. And it's local evangelism too, which is very exciting. Yeah, so praise the Lord for this project, SHINE, which is, I'm going to say, just one aspect of Pathway to Paradise. I know there's another part of Pathway to Paradise too that we want to cover.
Well, the thing that we've been doing since we started is public evangelistic series, mm-hmm. working with churches, and then weekend presentations as well. And we have several different seminars or weekend meetings that we can do. One that I wanted to talk a little bit about is Living in the Final Week. Mm-hmm. There is a deep and profound experience that God wants with His people.
Mm.
And actually, it's not just that He wants it, He actually promises that He will have it.
Yeah.
And that is best explained by a passage in Ephesians.
Okay. Ooh, yeah. Let's go there.
Yeah. Ephesians chapter 5. The Bible gives lots of analogies for the relationship that God and Jesus want with the church.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of those. It's the marriage relationship.
Yes.
I'm just going to pick a few verses here from Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 23.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of halfway through the verse, Christ is the head of the church, and He is the Savior of the body.
Mm.
And so this beautiful picture of how Christ is the head,
mm-hmm.
the church is the body. And I often use the illustration, when I got married to my wife, I did something that was really nice, I thought. I invited her to go on my honeymoon with me.
Amen. That's a good thing.
That's right. It's worked out great.
Yes. Just so you know, I did the same thing.
Oh, good. I'm glad to hear that. And there's a reason we do that, and that's because we want to be with our partner.
Yeah, that's right.
We want to be with our spouse. We want to be with our husband or our wife. Mm-hmm. And Jesus wants the same thing with the church. Mm-hmm. We can read a few verses later. It even explains it in stronger language.
Mm-hmm.
Looking now at Ephesians 5, verse 30. For we are members of His body, of His flesh, and of His bones. That's that unity
mm-hmm.
He wants with
us.
And then verse 31. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and they shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh.
Mm.
And that concept is something that has really grabbed me mm-hmm. as I've studied it and started to share it more. Jesus, we know, wants to be united with the human race, but it is a deep and profound connection that he wants with His church. And Living in the Final Week explores this connection from the angle of the life of Christ, and specifically the last week of His life.
Yes.
And so that's why it's called Living in the Final Week.
Okay.
We look at the final week of His life, and as we go through it from night to night, we see that the events that Jesus went through and His disciples with Him, those events were actually prophecies of what would happen to the church during the time period that the Bible calls the time of the end.
Wow. Seeing that connection and that correlation in there. I'm just looking. This is living in the final week, walking with Jesus at the end of time. This is the sample here of Bible Prophecy Seminar. I see you have a graphic there. But if I open it up in here, Tim, it talks about, this is powerful. God exits from eternity, 1 Timothy 1:17, origin of sin, creation, death enters, and it goes through the entire, all the way through history.
Yeah.
So is this a series of lessons that you go through in your
seminar? It's available as Bible study lessons. We just saw the picture of that on the screen. Those are available in English and Spanish.
Ooh, nice. Oh,
great.
Both mm-hmm. versions there.
How many in the series?
23.
Okay. Yeah.
So if we go to a church, it's 23 presentations, about 4 weeks for the full series. We can present it in a condensed way as well. But
And it correlates Jesus with the end time.
It does. And everything he went through,
I see that.
Chronologically, when we look in history, starting back in 1844, and moving all the way through the second coming, everything Jesus went through was a prophecy of something that his body would pass through in that time period leading up to the second coming. And the big overarching principle is that whatever happens to the head happens to the body.
Yeah.
Because they're united together.
Interconnected, one flesh.
Yep.
Wow.
Mm.
I'm looking at that prophetic gift, a test of faith, that's Luke 20, and then the prophetic gift given in Revelation 10.
That's right.
Wow. Parables of the judgment and then the investigative judgment and how they correlate together.
I could, we have a couple minutes, maybe we could look at one of these.
Okay. Let's do that.
Let's turn to Luke chapter 19.
Because it always helps me to kind of see what you're talking about. Like, we can talk in technical terms. Okay, this correlates with this. That's great. But if I actually see it from the Word of God,
that's right,
and experience it, that's a difference. So you said Luke 19?
Luke chapter 19. And we're just going to start with those first events that happened at the beginning of that final week of his life.
Yes, okay.
Which we know began with the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. I'm going to read verse number 11. This is Luke 19, verse 11. As they heard these things, he added and spake a parable, because he was nigh to Jerusalem, and because they thought that the kingdom of God should immediately appear. You know, Jesus, in those final days of his life, he allowed a misunderstanding.
He did.
To happen. The disciples thought he was going to ride into Jerusalem, set up the kingdom of God on earth, and that they were going to be enjoying their new positions in the kingdom very soon.
Right.
Well, we know that didn't happen. Instead, there was a disciappointment for those disciples a few days later. But if you look at the very next thing that Luke tells us Jesus did, this is later in Luke chapter 19, instead of setting up his throne, in verse 28, well, we read about the triumphal entry there. If you look at verse 45, I'm sorry, it's verse 45, it says, he went into the temple and began to cast them that sold therein and them that bought, saying unto them, it is written, my house is the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. Instead of setting up his kingdom here on earth, Jesus actually goes into the temple or the sanctuary.
Yes.
And he cleanses it.
Sure does.
And that has profound prophetic implications.
Oh, my.
Yes.
Absolutely it does.
Yes.
Well, you can trace this further. The very next verse, this is verse 47, says he taught daily in the temple. Well, that's kind of a passing comment in the book of Luke. Mm-hmm. But Matthew actually tells us in great detail what Jesus taught daily during those last days of his life. And we won't do it now because we don't have time, but viewers can go to Matthew chapters 21 through 25, and all of those chapters in the book of Matthew contain parables of the judgment. And Jesus spends the last week of his life in the temple telling parables of the judgment.
Wow.
And again, we understand from prophecy that the final judgment began
in 1844.
When Jesus went into the temple in 1844.
Yes.
So that's just a little example of the parallels that exist between the last week of Christ's life and what his body experiences and goes through.
Mm. So this 23-part series, if you want to call it that, is actually talking about then the final week, the entire 23 lessons.
Most of them. There's a few at the beginning that lay the groundwork.
Sure.
But most of the lessons look at events in the final week of his life.
So you teach the doctrines, we could say, as far as the Sabbath.
Absolutely.
And the sanctuary message and what happens when we die and healthful living, all of those from the perspective of the final week?
That's right. Let me give you one other
example. That's revolutionary.
I just
somehow had not even grasped that in the I knew you did evangelism, but I just, that's revolutionary.
Well, you know, in Revelation, the very first verse of Revelation says, this is the revelation of
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ. And so to understand all of these symbols, you know, and there's a lot of confusing things in the book of Revelation. You've got a dragon, you've got beasts, you've got scary things like the mark of the beast.
Mm-hmm.
And though they're important, if they weren't important, God wouldn't have put them in the Bible.
Yeah.
That's right.
But we have to remember that all of this is to reveal something greater, and that is Jesus Christ.
Mm.
And so the prophecies of Revelation and Daniel and other places in the Bible, all of those reveal Jesus at the end of time and what it actually means to walk with him at the end of time. Let me show you another.
Give us an example.
Yeah, another example.
Because I need something concrete to think about.
Let's go to the Gospel of John.
Okay.
And we're going to look at chapter number 12. This chapter describes his anointing at Bethany, and then in verse 12, it continues with his triumphal entry.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of an overview of the last week.
Yes.
But then it really focuses on a conversation that Jesus has with the Gentiles, some Greeks that came to visit him. And what Jesus tells them is really important. These are his last public words.
Okay.
This probably happened Thursday afternoon sometime. Mm-hmm. The Bible doesn't say that, but it's the last public words of God in the Gospel of John. Mm. So what does Jesus say? If you look in verse 24, one thing that Jesus says is he explains the gospel. He says, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abides alone. Mm-hmm. But if it die, it brings forth much fruit.
Mm-hmm.
That's the gospel in a nutshell.
Oh, it sure is.
Or in a seed, right?
Yeah, yeah. That's true.
Yeah.
And then a few verses later, this is verse 28, Jesus says, Father, glorify thy name.
Mm-hmm.
So he's trying to direct praise to God so that the Father can be glorified. Now, if we look at verse 31, Jesus says something else really interesting. He says, now is the judgment of this world.
Mm.
He's talking about a judgment that is happening in the world at that time, right then. And then at the end of that chapter, the very last thing that Jesus says, this is verse 48. He says, he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. So he's directing people's attention back to the Word of God.
Sure is.
And the very last verse says, I know that his commandment is life everlasting.
Mm.
These are the things Jesus talks about, the gospel, glorifying God, a judgment that is happening at that time, and then an urgent plea to order your life according to the commandments of God.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is the very last message that Revelation
14.
Exactly. The three angels' messages in Revelation 14.
Yeah.
Whatever the head has done, whatever happens to the head, the body must do as well.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
that's deep.
It's been our experience.
You know, that's deep.
I'm sitting here thinking.
It's different than how we normally study the Bible. Mm-hmm. You know, we think, okay, I'm going to study and see what God has to show me. And that's a wonderful thing.
Oh,
or
yes.
We think, I'm going to study and learn a deeper truth. And that's great. But this is revolutionary in how you look at the final events of Jesus' life in the final week and how that correlates to us as the body down at the end of time. And that's powerful.
No, it truly keeps Jesus at the center of
it
prophecy.
It does.
And as we go through the subjects, we look at all of the prophecies, we look at all of the unique doctrines, you know, the pillars of faith, practical godliness. It's all there in the life of Christ. You know, he is the way. He is the truth. He's the example that we have.
Amen.
And so that's what we try to bring out as we share this with churches and with communities as well.
Amen.
Yeah, wow,
so these are available. This product is available like this. I'm looking at this here, Living the Final Week. So all these lessons, the 23-part series is available for people to order and to like present themselves, or how do you do that?
Yeah, they're available on our website, pathwaytoparadise.org. And it's certainly free to share those, study them in their own small group. We want this message out there in whatever way works best, but we're certainly happy to come and either spend a weekend with a church or you know, a whole month if they want to share it with the community.
Okay, so that's interesting. So it's actually, because you said 23, so you're actually willing to come just for one weekend. And would you do just like a mass all 23 or how? I want to say knockdown version.
Bring your sleeping bags.
That's right.
See, this sounds a little stressful.
All night. So there's options.
That's
because
right.
You're actually willing, am I getting this right, that to go and actually present these at a church for a weekend or even, you said, 4 weeks. So tell us a little bit about that in the last few minutes.
Yeah, if it's presented in a weekend, it's more of a revival seminar or series. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of the groundwork that we would either pass quickly over or maybe not need to do if we're focusing on things that hopefully are already familiar, mm-hmm. by and large. Mm-hmm. And we'll just, you know, focus on those aspects that the church can benefit the most from. Mm-hmm. When we do it over a 3 or 4 week seminar,
yes. Oh, yeah.
You know, we move pretty slowly, and you have to build the building blocks.
And that would be more evangelistic in nature?
Correct.
Okay. Yeah.
So you said you've been busy.
We have been.
Yeah.
Wow.
Praise the Lord, because this is, I want to say, sort of brand new. I
mean, the last year you've been full-time. How many years has it been since you first had that call, when the evangelist called and you went forward?
A little over 8 years.
8 years. Yeah.
So the Lord is patient, and He brings, you know, He's brought us step by step.
Amen.
As well, and I'm thankful for His patience.
Amen. Isn't that exciting? It's just exciting to see what God is doing in your life and your wife, Stacy, and the family, the ministry that God is growing. And to me, it's encouraging because God calls you, God calls me, God calls each one of us into ministry. So we want to encourage you, whatever call He's put on your life. Maybe you went forward when an evangelist called. Maybe you heard a sermon on the radio and you said, yes, God, I want to step forward. I want to do what you've called me to do. We want to encourage you to get involved in ministry. Whatever God has called you to do, step out and to do that. What we want to do right now is to put the address roll for Tim and this ministry, Pathway to Paradise Ministry. It's a wonderful ministry. If you want to get involved in SHINE, if you and your family, your children want to come to Fletcher this next summer and get involved in that. If you want more information on the 23-part series, or you want them to come to your church, your area, for an extended evangelistic series, or possibly just a weekend, here is how you can do just that.
If you would like to know more about this ministry or how you can get your children involved in SHINE, then you can write to Pathway to Paradise Ministries, Post Office Box 23, Kingsville, Missouri 64061. That's Pathway to Paradise Ministries, Post Office Box 23, Kingsville, Missouri 64061. You can visit them online for Bible answers, newsletters, and more at pathwaytoparadise.org. That's pathwaytoparadise.org. Or you can learn more about SHINE at shinekids.net. That's shinekids.net.
Excellent information. And as always, if you fail to have a pen and paper ready, you can always call 3ABN at 618-627-4651, and they'll be happy to give you Tim Rumsey's contact information, which is for the Ministry of Pathway to Paradise.
That's
and
right.
Always, I tell you, it's a blessing, isn't it, to have these ministries present what God is doing through them. And it's always an encouragement.
It is. It always encourages and blesses my heart. And I know I've been blessed today as a result of you sharing
Incredible.
About the ministry and how God encouraged you to step out by faith. Now, one thing we failed to mention at the beginning of the program, and maybe we should have done this at the beginning, is you are an associate speaker for White Horse Media.
That's right.
With Steve Wolberg. And something that you present in the evangelistic series we're airing right now.
That's right. Another series called Fire from Heaven, and that is a four-part video series. They're 30 minutes each, and it looks at the judgment of God and the question, how does God respond to sin? Has He always responded the same way? Has He done it differently in the past? Will He respond to sin and deal with it differently at the end of time? And so we look at kind of these big questions, and The real focus of the series is to show that God never changes.
Yes.
The Bible's very clear about that. And so the way that God has responded to sin in the past, and we start by looking at stories in Genesis. And God always goes through a process of investigation. Look at the story of Adam and Eve. Why did He come in and look for Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden that first evening? Wow. He knew where they were.
Of course He did.
Knew what they had done. He didn't have to ask questions, but He goes through this process of investigation, not so that He can determine truth. He already knows.
He does.
Right.
But to give them an opportunity to confess,
yes.
to repent, and to understand and trust His character. You can look at stories through the entire Bible, especially in Genesis, and God always does the same thing. after Cain kills Abel.
I was just thinking of that.
Yeah, uh-huh. He talks with Cain.
Sure does.
He doesn't just kick him off. Mm-hmm. He gives Cain a chance to confess. Mm-hmm. And we see the same thing with the Tower of Babel.
Yeah.
God looks, he investigates before he confuses the languages. Mm-hmm. And a wonderful example is Sodom and Gomorrah.
Mm,
he personally
yes.
comes down and spends time on the ground, so to speak. And he investigates to see if the cry that has risen to heaven is accurate.
You know, what a picture mm-hmm. of God, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Love, care, concern.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful, isn't it? Wow.
It's a God you can trust.
And it makes you want to respond.
Yeah.
Do you know that to God like that?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah.
So in that series, we just look at those examples and a few others through the Bible and then apply it to Revelation and what Revelation mm-hmm. tells us is actually happening right now.
Amen. That's exciting. Now that series, I know this program that we're recording now is going to air several different times. Mm-hmm. So it might not be, Tim's series might not be airing currently when this program airs. We want to make that clear. But that's wonderful. Praise God for what he's doing in your life, in your family's life, and the work he has for you. So we just praise the Lord for that.
It's very humbling.
Yeah.
And exciting.
Yeah.
It's neat to be involved in ministry, isn't it? And be involved in God's work. And I know that... I'm going to just go out on a limb here because I'm sure it's true, but you have no regrets, do you, for stepping out by faith?
Absolutely not.
Mm.
And I know God is providing for you and will continue to do so. And again, we provided that contact information. I asked him, I said, are you fully booked for the next year? And he says, not quite. So if you do have interest in having him come to your church, either for a short weekend or maybe even for a longer series, make sure you do that. Because God is moving on this young family, and it's neat to see them stepping out in faith.
Mm-hmm.
We have a few closing thoughts in a couple of minutes, but before we get to that, we want to go to some important information.
Hello, I'm Molly Steenson, and I want you to know how much we appreciate your faithful and often sacrificial support of Three Angels Broadcasting Network. When God first impressed Danny Shelton to begin building 3ABN, he honestly had no concept of what God would eventually do with this ministry. He only heard the simple instruction given him to build a television station that would reach the world, one that would preach the undiluted Three Angels messages of Revelation 14. Danny moved forward in faith, and 3ABN television came on the air less than 2 years later. And from that day forward, it has continued to grow. Today, Three Angels Broadcasting Network includes 8 television and 4 radio channels over a vast network of stations around the world. These can also be seen and heard over the internet and on satellite. But that's not all. We also have a 3ABN book division as well as a 3ABN music label that publishes Christ-centered music CDs and DVDs. Our passion is to get the message to the world through any and every means we can. And we've been doing that for over 31 years. Thanks to you. Three Angels Broadcasting Network is here only because of your prayers and financial support. Through the years, we have been grateful to those who support us through a monthly check. Others choose to give their tax-deductible love gifts through recurring deductions from their accounts. But now, there are even easier ways to support financially. Our website now accepts your support through PayPal from the United States and other countries, making it easy for supporters to give in their own currency. We're also tremendously grateful for those who have chosen to become Blessing is On the Go evangelism team members, registering to give a monthly donation of any amount to support evangelism around the world and in their own neighborhoods. In return, each month we send them a DVD, CD, book, or Bible study to share with their family, friends, and neighbors. Please remember that Three Angels Broadcasting Network is a 501c3 nonprofit organization, and without your support, we would not be on the air anywhere. If the Holy Spirit impresses you to support, please send your tax-deductible love gifts to 3ABN, Post Office Box 220, West Frankfort, Illinois, and may God richly bless you.
Thank you so much for that. Tim, we just thank you for coming. Thank you for sharing your ministry and what God is doing in your life, in your family's life, and in the ministry. And we have just a few moments left of the program. Why don't you share a closing thought, something you want to share with our friends at home?
Sure. And thank you for the opportunity to be here as well. One of the verses that means a lot to me is Isaiah 43, verse 1. Mm-hmm. And that says, "But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee.
Amen.
I have called you by name, thou art mine." And I know that the Lord has a calling and a purpose for every single person. Again, it doesn't matter what our background is, how long we've been a Christian, how long we felt this desire to serve Him. He has a purpose and a calling for every single one of us. And there are people that only we can reach, and God needs, He needs me, He needs you, He needs every one of us to work for Him so that He can reach those people. And He needs everybody to be in ministry. And that's going to mean something different for all of us. Mm-hmm. We need to go to the Lord directly and ask Him, "What is your calling on my life? What is your purpose for me?" Mm-hmm. And He'll answer that prayer.
Amen. Sure, that's beautiful. Thank you for that. I believe in that with all my heart. God calls us each to something different, but we're all called to something. Mm-hmm. We're all called to ministry. So know that the 3ABN family will be praying for you and your ministry and what God has called you to step out and to do. And we want to encourage you at home to pray for Tim and to get involved supporting his ministry. You can contact 3ABN and we can give you that contact information again. Our time is all gone. Until we see you next time, know that we love you here at 3ABN, that we pray for you, and get involved in ministry. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.